What happens when two bass road warriors spend quality time talking music and life with one of their peers? Bassist, educator, author David C. Gross and bassist and head honcho of KnowYourBassPlayer.com, Tom Semioli, trade eights with the legends of rock, jazz, funk, blues, folk, country, and more. Notes from an Artist, revealing conversations with the legends who've created the soundtrack of our lives. What happens? You're about to find out. It's another episode of Notes from an Artist.
Well, David, it's another episode of Notes from an Artist. Aren't you excited?
Woo-hoo!
And to our listener out there, welcome to another great show. Our guest is author, journalist, Marc Myers. But first, let's talk about Notes from an Artist, David, since it is
our show.
Okay, if you want to know all things about Notes from an Artist, if you really want to get in the nooks and crannies of David C. Gross and Tom Semioli's life, and I warn you, you have been warned, you can go to www.notesfromanartist.com. And it looks great on your mobile phone. It looks great on your laptop. It looks great on your smart TV. Although, how smart are you if you watch Notes from an Artist on television?
On a TV. It's so true. It's so true.
You can follow us on Facebook. We don't put pictures of cats up. So you can follow us on
Facebook. But if you request it, we still won't.
We will. And if you follow us on Facebook, you can also learn more about David's website, the Bass Guitar Channel, and you can learn about my bass player website, oddly titled Know Your Bass Player. And you can also see us in the flesh on our YouTube page, or as much flesh as will allow you to see. And that YouTube page is, oddly enough, David Notes from an Artist. And of course, if you are really into some action-packed Monday nights at 8 p.m. Eastern time, please log on to www.cygnusradio.com. That's where you can listen to our show live, even though we tape it. But it is technically live because our audience member doesn't know any better. So you can listen to us on the Cygnus Radio.
Yeah, but by this time, our audience member probably does know better.
Probably does. Probably had a therapy.
Whoever it is been listening to us since the beginning, our listener.
Poor guy. And most importantly, you can listen to our podcast all day long, David. You can listen to it in the shower, in the bathroom. You can listen to it while you're being incarcerated. Our podcast is, oddly enough,
as a matter of fact, we are actually the number one podcast at Rikers Island.
Yes, we are, David. Matter of fact, when they put people in solitary, the only thing they allow them to do is to listen to the Notes of an Artist podcast.
They want torture. They want to torture all of these people.
Right. We're on Gitmo Radio. It's amazing where we are. But you can listen to our podcast on Buzzsprout, Spotify, Amazon, Apple, and wherever podcasts are podded. So let's talk about Marc Myers. We're going to do this show in, I think, 3 episodes, David? Is that what we're
planning?
It'll
be 3 episodes on the radio. But you lucky folk can listen to the whole thing.
The whole shebang, as they say up in Connecticut.
The whole shebang in one listening. And all of the songs we mentioned, plus songs that are in the book, which Tom will mention, are all on the playlist that go along with our podcast.
All right. It's all things Marc Myers. And of course, the name of the book is Anatomy of 55 More Songs, The Oral History of Top Hits That Change Rock, Pop, and Soul. I'm not going to go too deeply into the book because we do talk about this book extensively. Obviously, that's why Marc showed up. And we talk about some of his previous books. We do get into a bit of a tangle with him about the life of songs, because songs are changing now, and you'll hear that on our show. Songs are becoming more beholden to algorithms and timbre than they are to melodies in rhythm and lyrics.
Isn't that what they do when they cut a tree down? They go timber?
They do. Yes, they do. When they cut the tree that has the Cygnus Radio antenna on it, that's what
that's when people celebrate.
Yes. Actually, it's David and I will come to your house and do the show if you're that big a fan. We will do that. We'll sit in your kitchen and broadcast into your living room. We're very accommodating radio hosts. So, David, without further fondue, let us talk with Marc Myers.
Here you go.
Well, Mr. Marc Myers, welcome back to Notes from an Artist. You are one of the few returning guests. Let's talk about who we've had on more than once. David, we have Ron Carter has been on more than once. We have Dave Swift, Ron, the world's most recognized, or the UK's most recognized bass player. We've had John Altman as a guest twice. Are you familiar with John Altman, Mark? Do you know who he is? Arranger?
I probably am. I'm just not clicking in.
Okay.
Well, basically, he's done everything from co-writing Look on the Bright Side of Life to being Van Morrison's musical director, and he's written for Titanic. And
Okay.
Yeah, he's a wonderful book called The Hidden Man.
Right, and when you're talking about the anatomy of a song.
The Hidden Man.
Which is actually he is hidden in plain sight. But when you're talking about anatomy of a song, he was the arranger for Always Look on the Bright Side of Life, of course, the Monty Python classic, which Eric Idle came into John with a demo, just an acoustic demo, or maybe just strummed it in front of him. And it was John Altman's idea to make it like a Broadway type tune. And I understand it is the
Do you want to have him on instead?
No, we've had him on. You're rating with him. But I'll tell you, it's become the most popular song at funerals.
Actually.
Pre-ramble. And of course, we've had Jeff Berlin on twice. But David, for our listener who doesn't know who Marc Myers is, he's an acclaimed author and journalist. We acclaim him anyway. You've written a couple of books there, Marc. Now, you've written How to Make Luck, Seven Secrets Lucky People Use to Succeed. You wrote that book in 1999. Are those seven secrets still relevant in 2022?
Yeah, they're timeless.
Okay.
They're timeless, yeah.
All right. So then look that one up, David, because we need a little bit of luck in 2020.
I follow them every day.
Do you really?
Oh, yeah.
Okay. Is that like...
I'm just sitting around writing books and not believing what I'm writing.
Yes, exactly.
That's
fiction. I know. I'll write a book about, you know, how to assemble a DC-3, and I have no idea how to do it, but I'll tell them how to do
All
it.
All right. Well, you could probably get hired by the military industrial complex if you don't know what you're doing. Anyway, he's also written David Why Jazz Happened, which he published. That was 2013.
Yes, sir.
I actually bought that as a consumer. That is the social history of jazz. You talk to musicians, producers. A good book to read, David. You did your first Anatomy of a Song book in 2016, right?
Yes.
That's 45 right. Iconic hits that changed pop, rock, and rhythm and blues. And that was a great book. And we didn't know it was going to be volume one, right?
It was a runaway bestseller on Amazon, thankfully.
Look at that. And then, of course, last year you wrote Rock Concert, The Oral History as Told by Artists, Backstage Insiders, and Fans Who Were There. And David, that's where Marc revealed, at least in our interview, that he enjoys hologram concerts.
That's right.
I remember that. Yeah. Yeah.
All right.
Pointing out, I believe, that most people who go to the concert are seeing a hologram concert anyway.
You're right.
Since they're watching
that.
90% of it on the big screen when they're not going to get something to eat.
Exactly. So see that? I thought it was ghoulish watching dead people on stage, but Marc actually shed light on that. So a new perspective on that.
It's ghoulish talking to you. Actually.
It's goulash.
That's what's getting goulash.
Yes, yeah. Yes. Of course, Marc is the famous Marc Jazzwax Myers, which, in my opinion, is the most important jazz periodical out
there. Tom.
Honored. And you've won 3 awards for that.
Yes,
right?
Best blog of the year.
Look
as you
that.
Can see... I don't know what season it is. I never see the outside world. I'm vitamin D deficient. And all I do is sit and type all day long and all night.
Excellent. Excellent. Yeah. Good life. Good life you have. And of course, you are a contributor to Wall Street Journal. David, he writes arts and culture. He doesn't write any of that financial stuff. He stays away from that.
So I can't blame him for my 401.
Nothing. I have nothing to do with that. I write House Call, which is in the mansion section each week, in which I interview a Hollywood actor, well-known Hollywood actor each week on childhood. That's all that column is about, what it was like growing up. And then I also write the monthly column, which doesn't have a title, but it's been going on for over a year. I guess the best way to put it is album that turned 50 that changed music history.
Yes.
Yeah. And this month was Carly Simon's No Secrets, which went up online 2 days ago.
Right. I read that. And it's funny because I've been doing this photo essay, 72 at
yes,
50.
That's
and
right.
It's just an amazing, it was an just an amazing, amazing year for music.
It's a year in which albums held up and you yes. could actually listen to them now without being nostalgic. You know, kids are listening to it. So it's
right.
not like, hey, they're not really that good. You're just remembering when you were 18 or 12. That's why those albums sound good. No, they're actually really good because our kids or the generation that we're raising, kids in their late 20s and early 30s love these albums too.
Right.
They have fiber, this resonance.
Well, I think it's not only the content, the artistic content, but I think that's probably the year 72, 73 when recording technology sounds contemporary 50 years later. You know, you listen to records in the late 60s, other than maybe a record like Abbey Road or something like that, you can tell, yeah, that's a bit of archaic. But starting in 72, 73, records started to sound like what music sounds like now on broadcast.
For one very important reason.
Yes.
Component stereo systems became affordable.
Ah, okay.
The quotas on foreign imports were right. dropped, and Japan flooded the market.
Okay.
Almost every component stereo system was made in Japan. And thankfully, because the integrated receiver that the Japanese brought in here had this interesting second band on the radio, you could get AM on your receiver, but you also
right.
could get this new thing called FM.
Right.
And as a result, record companies had to step up because the stereo system sounded a whole lot better.
Right. And I think, David, what maybe 16 track around the early 70s now instead of the 8 tracks?
Yes. That started. I mean, originally, you know, they were just throwing a couple of 8 tracks together.
Right.
But they ultimately ended up building the machine that could do it all without any kind of syncing up, so to speak.
Right, right, right. So, yeah, a combination of right Japanese imports and home audio technology improving. And then, of course, on the recording
FM.
Industry side and FM radio. Right.
I mean, the big difference between FM and AM wasn't just that FM didn't have any advertising, so college age DJs could play full albums, you know, without
right.
any ad interruptions. The big deal there is that FM was stereo.
Mm-hmm. Right. Of course.
AM wasn't. AM was
right.
mono. So that if you had a home stereo system and you put on WNEW or any of the new FM rock stations, you were hearing it just as good as the album. In some ways, that's why most people bought an album, because they heard it in stereo on their integrated receiver from Japan.
Okay, all right.
And also, recordings were, I won't say cheap, but they were reasonably priced.
Yes, that's
so
very
you
important.
You hear one song, you like it, you could afford to go out and check out the album. It wasn't
right.
one of these things where, oh, I need to hear everything, or in today where it's just Playlist City.
And there again, one very specific reason why albums were cheap, why they were able to hold down the price.
Which is?
I was waiting for that. I was waiting for that, Tom. It's because you see the rise of the record supermarket.
Mm.
And there's so much floor space and so many different types of music now being recorded. Punk is suddenly being recorded. Glam is being recorded.
Right.
All kinds of subgenres of rock are being recorded. Not because they're interesting. They were interesting and they were creative. But it's because everything is business and technology. Any change has to do with business and technology. But with the rise of Tower, with the rise of Sam Goody as a national chain,
mm-hmm.
you suddenly have more floor space. With more floor space, you have more bins. With more bins, you need more product. And, you know, Beatles are gone. Led Zeppelin can only turn out so much. But then all these little, you know, these subgenre groups were getting signed to record deals because stores were demanding more albums.
That makes sense. And it's interesting, too, because I remember when I think it was in 60s. When did Substitute come out? The Hoot single.
Oh, 67.
Echo Records.
67.
So I would take the 104 bus from 68th Street down to Colony. And
Ooh,
they had
Colony.
At that time bins full of 45s. And you could buy virtually anything. But when you think of the LP in the 60s, because I do, because I was part of that generation, it wasn't that it wasn't important to have the sound really, really crystal clear and this, that, and the other thing. It was always about, as Ron Carter says, the big M, the music. That's what was important. And here I am, a much older man with ears destroyed by too many amplifiers and too many concerts. I still just want to hear the music. The concept of, oh, it's got to be pristine. I had an amazing stereo when I was younger. I'm using my computer speakers now, my monitors for my Pro Tools and things of that ilk.
Which are pretty good.
Yeah. It's just these aren't as good. That's the problem. The ears are suffering.
I mean, keep in mind, when the album comes, when the rock album starts to rise in the late 1960s and starts to get even better in the early 1970s, the fundamental difference between the albums, those albums and the albums of the 1960s is that the artists on the cover were actually playing the music.
Right.
Mm-hmm. I mean, most of the artists that you heard in the 1960s, the singer was singing, but almost every studio had their own studio group, whether it was the Wrecking Crew in L.A. or the Funk Brothers in Motown. And
Muscle Shoals.
Yeah, Muscle Shoals. Each studio had its own. And that's why you went to those studios, because you could get that sound out of those musicians. Suddenly, in the early 1970s, rock not only has more room, you don't have to have each song lasting 2.5 minutes. They could last 6 or 7 minutes. And they were actually, you know, they actually wrote a lot of those songs, and they performed them, and they sang them, and they recorded them, and they came up with systems and engineers that could actually get different sounds. So, you know, to Dave's point, it's a flowering enterprise in the early 1970s. And that's why the artists who had great amount of talent could actually document what they were doing. I suppose there were artists with great talent in the 50s and the 60s, but they were just puppets to the puppet master of A&R guys, or, you know, Mitch Miller type people who were just demanding that they record, you know, cheesy stuff or bubblegum or whatever the market would do.
Well, yeah, like Bobby Darin and Dion had a lot more depth to them than you would have than being teen idols.
Good point. Yeah, exactly.
Now, 55 more
songs. Anatomy of 55 more songs.
Now, we're going to do a deep dive on this, because I'll start off with the with my diatribe, because I'm concerned about your future, Marc.
But for man, no rest and no ending. He must go on, conquest beyond conquest.
Okay, I'm concerned about is the song In Crisis. Now, we mentioned John Altman, and we also, David and I, had a great discussion with Ben Neal. I don't know if we broached this subject with you, but since I'm going to relate it to some of the songs you wrote about, that the music that you and I grew up on, we're close in age. The music that David grew up on, we're all close in age. The music that your parents grew up on, the music that your grandparents grew up on, and maybe great-grandparents, was all based on two song formats. That was the Tin Pan Alley, AABA, and 12-Bar Blues, permutations thereof. And whether it was Springsteen or Frank Sinatra or Lena Horne, the songs fell into these two categories. Now, I looked at, let's talk about some of the songs you wrote about. Trucking, The Grateful Dead, that's a blues song. Bang-A-Gong, T-Rex, Mark Bolan, that's under the blues format. Long Cool Woman, the Great Hollies, comeback single, that's a blues structure. Smoke on the Water, Deep Purple, that's blues structure. Boys Are Back in Town, Phil Lynott in Thin Lizzy, that's a blues structure. Then we go around to Tin Pan Alley, Up, Up and Away by the Fifth Dimension, which you're right about, Tin Pan Alley. Ain't No Mountain, Hi, Diana Ross, Tin Pan Alley. Hello, it's me, Todd Rundgren, the ultimate Tin Pan Alley composer.
Hey, Tom, what is this, the Music Nuremberg Trial?
It is.
And if you looked at the cover, what I did is I wrote about singles.
Mm.
Singles run 3.5
minutes. There's an actual point to what
Tom's
saying.
No, but there's a point to it.
Oh, we're going, okay.
Yes.
No, I just wanted to
find out
whether
I know this is
needed a German translator or something.
Very interesting, but thoroughly supercilious.
Very good. David will translate for you.
Now, well, it is Hanukkah, you know.
Now, yeah. These songs appeal to us, and the reason you're writing about them 25 or more years later, actually the book ends in 1982, is because of the lyrics and the melody. And you mentioned in your book in the foreword that you believe it's a song to be considered iconic has to be at least 25 years old or older, right? Correct.
Yeah, correct.
Correct. Yeah. Okay. Now I looked at some of the big songs from 1997, which were 25 years old this year. Can't Nobody Hold Me Down by P. Diddy, or whatever his name is now, has no melody. Do You Make Me Wanna by Usher is just a two chord sample. No bridge, no intro, no really just two chord changes. Da Dip by Freak Nasty, number one hit in 1997. No melody. And maybe a synth line in the background that was pilfered from Depeche Mode. So if Dave Gahan is listening, get your lawyers on that one. Up Jumps the Boogie by Magoo and Timberland. No melody. See You When I Get There by Coolio. No melody. Just
So, Tom, this is... I'm interviewing you here. tell us about the songs you didn't write about.
My point is that how do we write about songs how can we write about songs in the future when there is no song? Now,
we can't. I've done all the songs. It's over. It's finished. Yeah.
Okay.
No, I understand what you're saying.
Right.
Yes, you're right. It's almost like we're going to IKEA to do a seminar on custom-made furniture, right? So, you know, the days of customized furniture in songwriting, you know, sort of ends with AM radio in some respects.
Okay.
Because AM radio forced songs to fit a particular mold.
Right.
Four songs to only last a certain amount of time, which meant you had to open big, you had to have a good hook, you had to have some riffs in there, you had to build toward a climax. The story in the song had to tell a story of something, most of the time about love or breaking up. And correct, it's a different thing. But the difference now and then, fundamentally, Tom, is that music is no longer designed to be stared at. And what I mean by that is music today is background. All of the songs you mentioned are largely, you can literally take the history, you can chart the history of the personal computer and the history of pop music. And you will see that as the personal computer, as we get to 2001 with the introduction of iTunes and downloadable music formats, that music becomes background. It becomes secondary. We listen to it while we write our emails. We listen to it while we work. We listen to it at the gym. We listen to it while walking around or while waiting in line. When I was a kid, and that means you guys, because we're about the same age, you looked at music. You sat in front of two speakers. You read an album back of the cover, or you read something, and or you looked at something, or you were focusing on the speakers and you were focusing on what you were hearing. And that's what you did with your friends.
Right.
I can't think of, except for the hi-fi, the vintage hi-fi collectors, and that seems to be quite a large number based on my Instagram feeds. Seems like there's just so much collecting of that kind of equipment. The only people who are sitting and listening to music that way are vintage-minded people. Most people don't listen to music that way anymore. So music doesn't have to perform certain tasks. It's like the giraffe, right? I'm sure the giraffe early on in civilization had a short neck, but the only way it could reach the tree to eat the leaves and survive is by growing its neck. So over, 10,000 years, it had a longer neck. It's the same with music. Music doesn't have to be, nobody's watching it anymore. People are using it as background. So it needs the beat. It needs a thumping. It needs to sound almost like white noise, you're working.
Yeah.
Well, it's interesting you're saying that, because I knew we were going to get here at some point in our conversation. So I wanted to bring up one date in particular.
Yeah.
And that was the year 1978.
Uh-oh.
And that was the year that it ended. And I'll tell you why.
What ended, music, David?
Music with bridges, A, B, C.
Mm. Hold on. Disagree with that. Let me finish.
Let me finish. The Nuremberg trial.
The defense has the right to present his case, you know?
We, the jury, find the defendant not guilty.
Go ahead, Dave.
Court TV.
Briney knows music for airports.
Okay. All right.
There was no anything in it. It was more tender.
Dave, can you give that to me again? I didn't catch that.
Music for Airports by Brian Eno. That really was the start of the end of a song form. And if you look at some of these rap artists and the later artists, they've taken this ambient thing, which, you know, you could also talk about Philip Glass.
Don't you think Kraftwerk was doing that a little earlier? I mean, computer music. I mean, a lot of those.
But I think for the Brian Eno thing, I think probably sold more and sort of entered into more homes, let's say.
Well, probably through you too, but I understand. I see what you're saying there, Mark, like Autobahn. Like I remember hearing that on the radio, on the FM radio. What was it, 74, 75? And it was strange because it really had no melody. It was just a beat and a guy repeating the word Autobahn.
Yeah. And I don't know that. I don't know that that's necessarily the case. I mean, again, you know, it may have been the start of ambient music, but one could argue that the beautiful music format was that as well in the late 1960s. So on FM radio. But I think the big shift really is what we expect and demand from music today. We no longer want it to be short and catchy. We kind of want it to be extremely long and backgroundy. At least when I say we, that doesn't mean you, us three.
I think we're talking when we means
the marketplace, right?
Right.
Because that's what the record companies are in business for.
Your wonderful book, because I got to tell you, the introduction should be required reading. For anyone that goes to a music school. Okay. All right. And that's my story.
I'll take
and
that.
I'm sticking with it. But as I said to you yesterday on Facebook, the Holly Ridge Strings. Yeah. I mean, Tom, did you notice that Brian Wilson, when he was going on stage,
yes,
he made a point of relaxing to his versions or the Holly Ridge string versions of his tunes, of the Beach Boys tunes.
That's a fascinating story.
Yeah. And for listeners who don't know what we're actually talking about, Holly Ridge Strings is an easy listening instrumental. It's almost like 101 Strings or Mantovani or Percy Faith. Exactly. But they did a lot of pop. They did a lot of pop covers as well.
Well, it's interesting because they were on Capitol Records, so they got the Beatles and the Beach Boys right off the bat. And early on, when albums had advertisements inside, you always saw at the bottom, "Oh, there's the Holly Ridge Strings, the Holly Ridge Strings."
That's right. Yeah,
yeah. And I mean, you know, keep in mind that gimmick of a label taking their teenage group's songs, if they were good, and turning them into adult fare by pressing them through the easy listening filter or prism. George Martin did that as well. Right. And when I interviewed Sir George, I asked him, I said, you know, I love those George Martin orchestra albums that came out in the early 60s. I mean, where you're covering Beatles songs with orchestration. I said, you did that so you could raise money to put together Air Studios, right? And he laughed and he said, yeah. He said, you know, adults wanted to hear this stuff. They didn't want to hear the Beatles doing it. But it turns out I Love You, Yeah, Yeah, Yeah became great if you put violins and orchestration to it. And also John Barry, you know, the James Bond. I mean, he had his own orchestra that did orchestral interpretations of his own works. So, you know, it's interesting how Holly Ridge Strings, the Holly Ridge Strings, you know, Brian listening, you know, for people who haven't read the book yet, but I'll tell you this story only if you buy the book, Anatomy of 55 More Songs. When I went to interview Brian Wilson and Al Jardine up in California when they were on their Pet Sounds tour at the California Mid-State Festival, which is sort of like an amusement park and a concert venue over many, many acres. When I went back into the trailer, I mean, the temperature was like 116 degrees that day. I couldn't believe how hot it was. And inside it was 73. I mean, the temperature was great in there. And Brian was sitting in a big thick leather on a thick leather sofa back there and sat down, and I had interviewed him before and said, "Hey Marc, come on, sit over here." And I sat down and we're talking, you know, just generalities, and I'm suddenly realizing that he's listening to something. And then as I'm listening now more closely to what he's listening to rather than what he's saying, I'm suddenly realizing it's like this easy listening version of Beach Boys songs. And I was kind of thunderstruck. I said, you know, Brian's obviously, it's not like he's an egomaniac to the point where he can only listen to music if someone's covering his songs. There must have been a reason, either therapeutic or pre-concert or something. I said, "What are you listening to there?" And he says, "Oh, Holly Ridge Strings. It's Holly Ridge Strings. You know, I love these guys." And I said, "They're playing the Beach Boys." He goes, "Yeah, isn't that great? Great, isn't it?" And I said, "Yeah, yeah." And I said, why are you listening to it?" And he goes, "It relaxes me. You know, Brian always says things in twos very often. He goes, "It relaxes me. It relaxes me." He goes, "You know, before I go on, it gets me in the mood. It gets me feeling great, and it just puts me at ease." And, you know, people forget that almost every artist I've interviewed is terrified of performing until they get on stage.
Really?
But yeah, there's just terror. I mean, you know, there's stage fright. There's an enormous fear of performing. And all of them are jittery. I mean, even if you watch Frank Sinatra, that video of the main event.
Yes, sure.
Where he's coming down and he's in the back of Madison Square Garden with his entourage. And he's waiting there until they give him the go to go through the doors to go out. He's absolutely terrified. I mean, you can see it. He's nervous as can be.
Yes.
Beatles were terrified before they went out, at Shea for a variety of reasons. John was absolutely terrified that they were going to get killed at one of these stadiums.
Sure. Terrified with the plastic on a band.
Yeah. And I mean, you can. It's interesting. If you watch the Beatles at Shea documentary, you can see a moment there where a girl breaks loose and manages to zigzag enough that she's about halfway to the pitcher's mound, to where the stage is, second base. And the cops finally grab her, like at the last minute, sweep her off the ground by her waist, and they're hauling her back to the stands. And the audience, 55,600 people, are, you know, boo, boo. And Paul, young Paul, who sort of feels like he has to sympathize with the audience, right? I mean, that's Paul's nature, is starting to boo as well from the stage. And John, who's absolutely freaking out, you know, with his guitar, you know, before they're playing the next song, sort of does a 180 degree turn toward Paul. And it's almost like you can see his lips say, "Are you effing crazy? Are you absolutely crazy?" I mean, the last thing they wanted was 55,600 people pushing past the 12 policemen who were on the field and storming the stage, and the Beatles unable to get out of there in time. You know, it would have been a very, very dangerous situation. So point there being that performers are, before they came out at Shea, I think in the rock concert book, I had somebody who described how they looked just before they left to go out on.
Right.
And they were saucer-eyed, I think is how he described them.
Yes.
Just thunderstruck by the crowd, terrified of the whole experience, and nervous as can be.
Wow. That's a very interesting observation. And I noticed that with a lot of, now that you say that, a lot of the Elvis Presley documentaries.
Perfect.
You
absolutely
see a guy that is
right.
And you think, see, David, we're bass players. Nobody looks at us anyway. But you would think, I would think that, my gosh, people are here to like you. You could probably sing three notes out of key. You could, you know, like everyone's going to come. They're there to love you. Yet these performers are still absolutely terrified. And yes, that's a fascinating story about how Brian Wilson needs to relax before a concert. My God, they're there to pay homage to them. He has so many background singers doing the heavy lifting anyway. I mean, he just has to walk out on stage.
Well, you see, you're describing things rationally and logically, which is how we think when we walk around the city or we go start to meet a friend. But if you've done a lot of television, I have, and if you've done major media like the Today Show and Nightline and other shows like that, which I have, even though you're prepared as can be, there's terror. And there's terror because you are afraid that you are going to forget what you're supposed to do. And they know what they're supposed to do. Brian knows what he's supposed to do. But there's terror that suddenly, I mean, vocalists, even Ella Fitzgerald had phenomenal levels of anxiety and fear before performing, which you would think is absurd. But her big fear was always that she was going to forget the lyric. And in fact, in Germany at one point, I think this was the first time, I can't remember exactly when, but she did forget the lyrics to Mack the Knife. They're very complicated. She turned to scat. And in fact, scatting for her began because she forgot the lyrics at one point, whenever she began scatting in the 30s or the 40s. But that's the biggest terror for a singer, that they're going to forget the lyrics to a song in the middle of being out in the open, in where the stakes are at the highest. I mean, imagine Tony Bennett singing on Ed Sullivan, where you've got 7 million people watching on Sunday night in the 60s, if he forgot the words to a song. I mean, that's ever present. So being on stage in front of people at a big, big, large event is terrifying for anybody, even Brian Wilson, who basically ratchets that down and gets into the right frame of mind by listening to the Hollywood Strings play his song.
You know, Mark, what's interesting about that, too, is if you think about Brian's predilection for that kind of music, I mean, it started with the vocal groups for freshmen and middle-of-the-road stuff going all the way back. And if you look through, I guess, after the Chuck Berry rehashing that they did, he did a lot of soft songs. He wrote a lot of soft material.
Oh, you're talking about Brian?
Yeah.
I mean, the music is romantic, and there's a Peter Pan quality to a lot of his music. There's a childlike innocence to it. I mean, even Smile, it seems so silly in places, but at the same time, it's enormously sophisticated if you accept Smile as a work of art, that there's actually something more going on there than that. You know, the Brits had this too. You know, they had this whole subgenre of rock, of pop rock called Toy Town, which were sort of childlike songs with easygoing melodies. And but the Beach Boys have that, you know, there's an innocence to them. But they do, as you point out, Dave, you know, as you point out with the Four Freshmen. But, you know, that tradition dates back to the Bird groups of the late 40s, like the Ravens and the Crests, and then even earlier with the Mills Brothers and the Ink Spots, and back to the Andrews Sisters. So vocal harmony was a big band staple. The Four Freshmen put a hip jazz Stan Kenton-like spin on jazz vocals. And that's and Brian's picking up that sound on the West Coast. There's a West Coast jazz element to what Brian's doing with the Beach Boys as well at that point.
Absolutely. Yeah. Absolutely. Yeah. The whole Chet Baker kind of thing. Yeah.
Relax.
Which is why, you know, to certain people, Chet Baker sounds just completely off key. And you know what? I can understand that, but his inflections are so trumpet-like that I love listening to early Chet Baker myself. I just think it's some of the...
Yeah, I mean, the beauty of Chet is that he sounds like anyone singing, right? It doesn't have to be in key. You know, you basically hear him and you say to yourself, that's me singing, right? Because, like, it's not pristine, it's not perfect, it's not... The pitch isn't exactly right. But at the same time, the music that Chet is singing comes across less as a song and more as a sigh, doesn't it?
Yes.
Yeah,
much like Johnny Cash or Willie Nelson in that sense.
Yeah. Yep. There's a sigh-like quality to Chet's voice that relaxes you instantly.
Let's get to some of your songs because I got to
The book.
The book. It's all about the book.
Yeah.
Well, let me...
How did you start Atlas Shrugged?
Well, you talk about looking at music, and one of the things that struck me, one of my favorite chapters in this was Papa Was a Rolling Stone.
Yeah.
And I think about that song.
Wow, right?
And again, that's 1972, David, and how you describe, and you point out to me, I didn't realize it, how each singer became a character in the song. One singer was the father, the other singer was a child. And again, I hear this song 50 years later, I never get tired of it because it's like a movie that's playing in my mind.
Yeah, I mean, think about it. I think that bass solo lasts, what, 4 minutes in the single before anything actually happens?
And we don't know who the bass player is. It could be Bob Babbitt. We don't know if it's Jamerson or Larry Taylor.
Right. It was never identified. And I interviewed one of the guys on the date.
Okay.
I can't remember. I think he's quoted in that. I'm sure he's quoted in there. I would have used him if I quoted him. But he's still, even the bass players who are on there don't remember who actually was there.
Sure.
That very often when that happens, in my experience, that's because they had a recording session on Monday. They did a recording session on Tuesday. They did a recording session on Wednesday. Wednesday, the original bass player couldn't make it and a second backup bass player came in. And then Friday, they had to do overdubs on the bass to fatten up the sound. So a third bass player came in. So nobody remembers who actually is on there. And in fact, they're probably all on there.
Some bottom so that the dancer just won't hide.
And then, of course, as Carol Kay mentions in her book, a lot of times they would take one backing track and use it for several different vocalists. So
correct.
You don't know, right? And it was another day at the office to these guys.
Except whoever came up with it. Yeah, that's the brilliance, right?
Right,
of course. It's that sound, which immediately, it's almost cinematic. And in many ways, that sound, I mean, Pop Was Rolling Stone is 72.
Right.
And I think actually Shaft was out already, right? Shaft is like 71. So I have to assume that that bass solo is somewhat a play, you know, somewhat of a blood relation
to the Curtis Mayfield.
To the Shaft feel. Yeah. Because it has that cinematic quality where you're listening to it and you know something doom and gloom is coming, something sad, something theatrical. You know, there's a story coming. So it telegraphs that, and it sort of sets you up for what the lyrics are going to tell you.
Right, right. Again,
well, I must tell you, growing up, when I grew up in the 60s, anything that was too poppy, I would overlook. And then Elvis Costello did a record with Burt Bacharach. You see how I'm segueing this into your book?
It's a great album, and it's hard to find that album. I mean, you can get it on, I'm sure it's on Spotify, but I mean, to actually have the CD or the vinyl is very, very, they should really reissue it.
Mm.
Yeah. So Painted from Memory was my first real serious listen to Burt Bacharach.
Mm.
So I started, as most people do with jazz, you know, you listen to Miles Davis Electrics, you're going to go back to Kind of Blue.
Yeah.
Well, outside of The Blob, which was a Bacharach David song. Believe it or not, Walk On By. Think of it as Walk On By. But then you read the story of the book, and that's 55 more songs, folks, by Marc Myers. And you go, wow, it was a women's movement song before the women's movement.
Yeah, I mean, you have to remember that when that was released in 64, I believe, almost eight of the 10 singles on the chart, the top 10, eight of them had the word love in it. It was all love. I love you, going to the chapel, you know, love this, love that. I mean, love is in the title. And if it's not in the title, it's implied. I think Louis Armstrong may have had Wonderful World out at that, or Hello Dolly. Hello Dolly, I think, was in the top 10 as well. That's the only one but that doesn't really count because it's really a show tune, right?
Right.
But Walk On By is an adult. I mean, see, this is the thing. Everybody thinks of the early 60s as everybody loved the Beatles, or everybody was listening, or parents were listening to classical. And that wasn't the case. You know, parents were listening to a lot of Percy Faith, Tony Bennett kind of things, and kids were listening to the Beatles. But they forget that in the middle there were young adults who weren't yet married. So they weren't screaming kids, and they weren't retired. Retired, not meaning they're not working, but retired meaning they're staying home on the weekends to listen to music. You know, they were active people. They were, you know, they were dating. They were maybe, you know, hoping to get married very soon. And what they were listening, the music that they were listening to were things like Burt Bacharach and Dionne Warwick and Tijuana Brass and more adulty sounding things that were kind of easy, but at the same time had a bit of fun going on. Now, Walk On By is a really adult theme because, you know, as it was described to me by Burt, you know, this was basically a song, you know, that Hal David had put together based on what he had overheard. And he overheard a conversation of two young adults. They may well have been black. And the two women, I think, were talking. You know, Dionne Warwick imagines this because we don't know because Hal David isn't alive. But because she said he took everything from what he had heard, whether on an elevator, on a subway car. But you could just imagine that there's a woman talking to another woman about you know, her breakup, and that a guy tried, you know, the guy who broke her heart was trying to sort of talk to her and trying to maybe rekindle things. Excuse me. And as he approached, you know, if you see me walking down the street, you know, walk on by. And how David heard that phrase, walk on by. And he had never heard that phrase before. You know, it most likely was a, you know, an urban, you know, right. phrase or a hip phrase, and like step off, right? So walk on by, yeah. meaning like don't look at that, talk to the hand. Don't even stop to talk to me. You know, you broke my heart. Walk on by, walk on by. And so it's an adult theme. And yet it's a song that appeals to younger people as well, largely because it's so friendly, right? It's arranged so friendly. You don't quite know what walk on by means. You don't quite know what's going on in there if you're a teenager. You know, the Beatles stuff was what you were listening to then, and Dave Clark Five. But yet there was something about that song was telegraphing adulthood. Sort of like when you got Rubber Soul. You know, I remember when I first got Rubber Soul, I was 9. And the cover immediately said, this, it was like holding a mirror to myself of how I would look at 17. In other words, the Beatles were, you know, they were sort of just young. You didn't quite know how old they were pre-Rubber Soul. And then when you looked at Rubber Soul, they suddenly looked very grown up, very adult. And you were basically holding an album in your hands, letting you know, hey, in a bunch of years, you're going to be going through all this stuff. As you listen to it and as you look at this cover, we're grown up now. We have facial hair. You know, we're dressed older. We're not wearing matching suits and Pierre Cardin suits anymore. We're right. grown up. But this is you. This is what you need to know as you grow up. And that's kind of like what Walk On By was doing. It's kind of saying to girls mostly, this is what you're going to need to know. That guy you really have a crush on, the guy who says like he loves you and you're holding hands with him all the time because you're very young. Somebody like that's going to break your heart. And this is how I responded to that kind of situation. It's a very interesting song if you put it in the context of its time period and everything else that was going on.
Well, I made a point of listening to it after reading the story, and it's not just the lyrics, that music. And Burt Bacharach was really sophisticated. He had Amazing. A lot of interesting ideas that the flugelhorn, well, the muted trumpet and the flugelhorn, both of those, you could hear them in so many different songs, and you go, that sounds like a Burt Bacharach tune. That sounds like his kind of, the fact that he was using two pianos versus five pianos in another one of his
songs. You know, I asked him, I said, Bert, obviously are familiar with the trumpet. Why the flugelhorn? Why did you use two of them? I mean, for me, when I interview, I do a ton of research, hours and hours of research, because I need to know everything that has been written so that I can go beyond that or even ask more granular details that can be even more revealing. So for me, I love asking what I call stupid questions. And, you know, it's just like an obvious question. And I said, why do you think? And I said, I think the flugelhorn probably because it's fleshier. And he goes, exactly. He said, it just feels human. It feels human voice. The trumpet is too piercing. It's too harsh. I can't remember the exact word I used in the book. I think it was harsh or too abrupt or too imposing. And that the flugelhorn, you know, when she sings walk on by, and the flugelhorn goes bop, 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 bop. Walk, it echoes her. So it's basically functioning like a chorus. An average arranger would have used background vocals there.
Exactly.
And instead he used two flugelhorns, and I said, well, why didn't you overdub? You know, you could have had the one flugelhorn play the part and just have him overdub right on top of it, or just take the tape and re-record, you know, take that exact tape and come under it, you know, for the master. And he goes, I wanted it to be uneven. I wanted it to be like two different sheets of paper not quite lining up so that you could see the humanness, the cry.
Vulnerability. So,
yeah, the vulnerability and the unevenness and the imperfection of two things playing at the same time. He said, these guys are crack players, but when you put two people together, it's like two fingerprints. They're just never going to match up,
right.
No matter what. The personality of the artist, of how he's blowing through the horn, through the mouthpiece, how he's pushing the valve down. The
articulation, yeah.
Yeah, the phrasing is going to be slightly different, and that is going to make all the difference in the world.
The art of recording.
And, of course, that supersonic reverb from the early 60s recordings. There's something, I mean, even when you go back a little further to Johnny Mathis with Chances Are or Wonderful, Wonderful, you've got this supercilious, airy reverb. And all this stuff. And it all kind of morphed into Walk On By. And if you think about it.
Yeah, I mean, the issue you bring up, something very interesting, Dave, which reminds me, any other arranger would have just used three background vocalists.
Mm-hmm.
But what Burt wanted was he wanted a soulful sound, like a church sound in the vocal, but he also wanted voices that would emulate strings, that would be almost angelic, choir-like. So in other words, he wanted choir meets the gospel sound. And he had six people doing background vocals there. He had three sort of gospel lower voiced Walk On By, and then you had the higher three singers recording the more airy angelic sound. So there's two sets of vocals on there. For Burt, these things matter. It doesn't matter, as he said to me, it doesn't matter whether you can hear them or not. It's that your heart will hear them. And that was such an interesting expression for me, because it's almost like a great plate of food, right? You might not be able to identify every ingredient in that plate of food. And that could be a veal parm sandwich, right? I'm not saying it's high-end food. I'm saying anything that you find that tastes incredible and you can't quite figure out why it tastes so special, you might not be able to pick out the ingredient, but your heart tastes it. You know, there's something about the taste that makes you swoon, really. And that's the same thing with Burt. The two pianos, you know, one playing those eighth notes, that impatient. I said to him, the eighth notes on the piano there, it's almost like her nails are tapping the table. Like, I told you, Walk On By, like, I'm impatient. Like, why are you still in my face? There's all these little things that are theatrical, but at the same time, the texture is what is so, it's the simplicity and the airiness combined with the complexity and the texture. It's a magic trick that Burt pulls off in these recordings with Dionne Warwick and almost everything he touches.
That particular style begot Jackie D. Shannon. I mean, if you think about all the artists that modeled what he was putting out at that point. Oh, another thing, one of the six vocalists found interesting was Valerie Simpson.
Yeah, people, I was about to say forget, but they may not know that Valerie Simpson, A, is a great songwriter. You're often surprised by the number of songs you know that she had a hand in. Second, that she's an accomplished pianist. You know, Ain't No Mountain High Enough in the book, Anatomy of 55 More Songs. Valerie's actually playing piano on Ain't No Mountain High Enough. And also, she's a marvelous arranger.
Absolutely. But that was great. But then the next song that I thought really, it typified the era in that sort of light adult age group was Up, Up and Away.
It's funny, the songs I pick, you by chance had asked me, why did you pick the songs you picked? I really want the songs that I pitched, you know, to my editor, the songs that I wanted to do, they wanted them to be immediately recognizable when the reader saw the title, but they weren't played. And what I mean by that is, they're not in advertising. You know, you don't hear them all the time. When I interviewed Keith Richards for
Make It Street, So Hard.
My first book, he was almost apologetic when he said, okay, Marc, what song do you want to do? I said, well, what are you thinking? What are you thinking, Keith? He goes, oh, I was going to talk about Street Fighting Man. But I can talk about Jumpin' Jack Flash. I can talk about Saturday. I mean, if you want to do, he was almost apologetic. Like he was pulling me to the main highway of the Stones. And I said, no. Let's do Street Fighting Man. I said, my brother and I fought over that 45 when that thing came out. I said, there's a lot of fascinating stuff going on in there. And he goes, well, I won't talk about it because I had the strongest hand in it. you know, mostly everything else is, you know, Mick and me, but I really had a lot more to do with that song. So there's an example. Like if I were going to interview members of the Doors, if they were still around, I mean, I interviewed the Doors for my first, my first book, Light My Fire. But if three of them were still here, there's only
Robbie Krieger and John Densmore.
Yeah, if they're three, I would want to do Touch Me because it's offbeat. You see what I'm saying? Yes. It's a great song, but it's just not one of the mainstream. So the songs that I picked, I wanted to be a bit off, you know, bit not part of this. And Up, Up and Away was always such a strange song for me. I mean, I loved it, but it's like, it's one of those songs where I don't know anybody I don't know anybody riding in a car. I don't know anybody who's ever said or admitted, I don't know if anybody could ever take a lie detector test to this, that when Up, Up and Away came on, they turned it off. Because the opening has that big brassy Marty Paich, ba 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 ba. It's just a sensational opening. And then the song itself is just, you really feel like you're flying away. I mean, it's just impossible. It's something about that song that, and I wanted to know what the secret was behind that song. Why is it that I feel that? It's like Groovin'. Who turns off Groovin' when it comes on by the Rascals? So, and you know, there's a lot of songs you turn off. And I'm saying some of these songs, you might turn off September in Anatomy of 55 More Songs, but Up, Up and Away, no one's ever turned that thing off when it's arts. And, you know, interviewing Jimmy Webb was terrific to get every last ounce of what went into that song, how it came about. The story behind it is just, it was unbelievable to me.
Yeah, it was fascinating.
Yeah.
I wish you would have asked him one question.
Yeah.
And the question was,
I'm sorry, give it to me again.
Who put the cake out in the rain?
Well, that's MacArthur Park, right?
I know. But still, you know, it's the one question everyone asks.
Yeah. Well, I mean, MacArthur Park actually exists. See, that's the reason I didn't do MacArthur Park.
Right.
Because it's been done to death. You know, if you go to Wiki, it's all there. And it's almost like there's not going to be an answer to your question because that's the art of it, right? That's the clashing of words. That's Sunshine Superman. What does that mean? He Donovan loved the two words together. I mean, there was a meaning why he chose Sunshine. There's a reason why he chose Superman. But putting those two words together, it just sounded to the artist. It was a fun combination. Right. You know, it was irresistible. Right. And that's, you know, Up, Up and Away. I mean, where that song was originally, Jimmy Webb wrote that while he was at community college under the assumption that the DJ who suggested they write a song together was interested in creating a treatment for a movie that instead of teenagers and cars would be teenagers and ballooning in the desert. I mean, that's what Jimmy Webb was thinking when he was writing that song, which it's like, you have to remember the Beach Movie was so hot when Up, Up and Away was written originally, the music. And it's a cinematic theme song you would have to a teenage, to a couple, you know, falling in love while ballooning, you know, with everybody, with all their friends in the California desert. You know, it's words and music by Jimmy too. So, and then the whole idea comes to him because he gets taken up, in a tethered balloon 100 feet and couldn't believe how the sun was coming through the panels of fabric, which looked almost like stained glass. And he just felt, wow, it's like Up, Up and Away. But the title Up, Up and Away actually came from his youth. It was what, if you go back to the, if you go to YouTube and listen to the radio broadcast, not the television, but the radio broadcast of Superman, that's what Superman said before he took off, Up, Up and Away. And that's where that title comes from. So that's the great thing about these songs. There's all these little nuggets of information that tell you it's the various parts of how this thing that you loved listening to and still do, how it all came together, how this crazy thing managed to happen.
Yeah. And one of the things
I'm going to try and find when we play this song, I don't know if you remember, but when TWA was an actual airline.
Oh, of course.
And they used this particular song as an advertisement.
I think it was Pan Am.
Okay. No. Da, 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 TWA.
No, but that wasn't Up, Up and Away. Anyway. way, one of those two airlines. But yeah, I mean, it was just a natural, you know, it's a natural fit. It's like advertising takes songs today. You suddenly hear a song you loved for like some medication to stop heart attacks. You know, it's like so depressing. It's like
big
never
pharma.
You mentally just cross that song off from ever listening to it again.
Yeah, yeah. Well, I think one
that's
of the
destructive thing about advertising.
I beg to differ. I just got it.
Heart medication?
Wouldn't you like to fly up and away? Wouldn't you like to fly up and away?
If you take our hand, we'll chase your dream across the sky. For we can fly, up and away.
Pick a star in the twilight canopy and search the world for the sights you long to see.
Your heart is young, you're alive, so come with me. TWA, up and away.
What is that, David?
TWA.
Oh, that's your TWA. Well, one of the things readers are going to take away from this book is the importance of the role of the producer in all of this, because we don't think about producers. We know the names and the faces on the record covers.
And they often made the final call that actually made it a hit.
Well, you is no more demonstrated than in Bob Ezrin when you talk about Alice Cooper's I'm 18, which was a anthem for my generation, and that there was this epic Alice Cooper jam that he didn't even get the lyrics to right. And he says, come on, guys, we got to dumb it down. And he turned it into that three chord tour de force in there.
Alice Cooper in 1970-71 was on the fast track to obscurity. They were...
Easy action, yeah.
They were two ticks away from working in a shoe store. I mean, they were over and done. Their first two albums just did not generate anything whatsoever. And they were going to get dropped. And they had one more shot. And because Bob Ezrin felt strongly about them after seeing them at CBGB, he said to the label owner, I forget the label, but he said...
It was Warner Brothers.
Yeah, but it was a Canadian...
They were on straight.
Yeah, exactly. Okay. And he said to the guy who owned the owner of the company, said, get rid of these guys. Go down to New York and fire them. That's why I'm sending you down. You got a ticket, round trip ticket. You're leaving tomorrow morning. Your job is to go there, fire these guys. They're just not happening. We got to get somebody else. We can't afford this anymore. And so Ezrin goes down to fire them. And at CBGB, freaks out. I mean, the people there are just animated. They're wearing eye makeup. You got Alice Cooper. It's just a whole theatrical thing. And I think when Bob he's so excited. Bob wasn't going down to produce them. He was going down to fire them, as I just said. And he goes down there, and he rushes backstage. And I forgot how he botches the name of the title.
I'm Edgy.
He goes, I love that song, I'm Edgy. And like Alice Cooper, the band's looking at him like, are you stoned or what's the problem? He goes, no, your song, that last song, I didn't have anything to drink. I'm Edgy. That's great. And he goes, no, that's out. I'm 18. You know, they couldn't quite make it out. And Ezrin couldn't make it out. Yeah, I'm 18. He goes, I'm going to produce you. And he goes back to Canada. He says to his boss, boss says, hey, good to see you, Bobby. He goes, so did they take it hard? You know, how did you tell them? And he goes, no. He goes, I'm going to produce their next album. And he goes, Bob, I sent you down there to can these guys. He goes, no, they're great. I'm telling you, it's going to work. I'm telling you, they got a great song. It's going to hit. The guy goes, fine. You produce them, and if it doesn't work out, you and Alice Cooper, I'll be sending somebody to fire you and Alice Cooper. Yeah. So right. Bob basically says, you know, Shep at this point, there, you know, Shep Gordon's already moved them to the Midwest, because the Midwest is, you know, it's where their records are doing best.
Right.
And it's also where... It's also the part of the country that's suffering the most economically. Unions, I mean, the factories are all moving overseas. Factories are shuttering. Parents are getting divorced because dads are sitting around watching TV all day. The wife has to go to work to put food on the table. Dad feels emasculated. They're fighting all the time. Kids want out of the house. So the kids are really responding to all the groups in the Midwest, like MC5 and Iggy.
Right. You mentioned this Grand Funk. Yeah.
Yeah. So Alice is up there, and they're, I think, in Pontiac. They rented a ranch.
Right.
And they're playing in the barn, and Ezrin's got them rehearsing there. And they play I'm 18 for Ezrin. And Ezrin, as you point out, Tom, is like, doesn't understand the lyrics. They're singing too many of them. It's just jammed. There's too many notes. And what Ezrin does as a producer is he basically takes the design apart and realizes he can reassemble what they're doing with far fewer parts, mm-hmm. so that audiences can have a better experience. And if it wasn't for the producer, in that case, you would never know who Alice Cooper is or was.
Right, right. And he played such an important role in the history of rock concerts, as you wrote in your previous book. Another one I really enjoyed was you got to talk to Bernie Taupin.
Yeah.
And his most regretted lyric is Mars is cold as hell, because Mars isn't cold as hell. How was Bernie
It's a privilege, yeah. I have to tell you. I mean, to interview these people, I don't interview these people because I'm interviewing A-list actors every week. Right. I mean, I'm up to my 500th column, actually, in January for House Call.
Wow.
I'm not a fan. I am a fan of their art.
Yeah.
I'm not a fan of their celebrity.
Yeah.
So when I come to talk to these people, they know that I'm not there because I'm fawning over them, or that I have all of your albums, or I know every one of your lyrics. Here, let me sing them for you. I'm coming to them as someone who has enormous respect for what they do in terms of their art. And, you know, when I sent my pitch in to sort of, you know, interview Bernie, I basically wrote that. And I said, I don't want to talk about trash. I'm not here to talk about Gotcha. I'm not here to talk about garbage, rehab, ex-wives. I'm just here to talk about the craft of what you do, the art. And, you know, I got word, you know, this person called up and said, Bernie wants you to come out to California and do it out there. So I flew out and we sat down for about an hour and 15, 20 minutes.
Yeah, it's a ranch in California. Yes, that's
But we did it.
Tumbleweed Connection.
I think we did it in, it was either Century City or Wilshire. I can't remember where we did it. But we did it in a conference room. And we had the greatest time. I mean, he just took me. He sensed immediately that I knew as much as or more than he did about the story. and that I was going to push him and turn him upside down for stuff that I would shake things out that he forgot or had repressed or wherever it was.
Yeah.
And, you know, he took me through the whole, you know, step by step, blow by blow.
Driving to his parents' house. That's fascinating.
Yep. Up at the parents' house and Elton's mom's house. And, you know, when he was driving up to see, he took the train. He drove up to see his parents.
Right.
In 2 to 3 hours outside of London. And by the time he got off the highway, it was dark. And as he's driving the back lanes and roads up there, which you can't drive very fast on, you can go fast, but you can't go very fast because they twist and turn.
Right.
He's looking at the sky and he can see the stars because it's pitch black in the countryside there. And he's starting to think of the Ray Bradbury story. And he starts to come up with the first verse in his head. But this is pre-cell phone and pre-electronics and pre-anything. And he doesn't have a pen to pull over and start writing it on paper. So Bernie is basically repeating the verse over and over for the next hour as he's driving to his parents' house. When he finally pulls onto the gravel driveway and pulls in, and he jumps out of the car, storms past his parents who wonder what the heck's wrong with him. And he rushes inside and grabs a pen and dashes down the lyric that he had for Rocket Man. And that was the start of it. And the interesting thing I think that's most fascinating about the Bernie Elton relationship, artist relationship, is that the lyrics always came first.
Yes.
Which seems inconceivable, right?
Right.
You know, it's just... You would just always imagine, like, if Bernie wrote the lyrics to Rocket Man, that the music would have, he would have listened to a tape of Elton's piano,
sure,
piano playing and come up with that. But no, he wrote the lyrics to that first, Rocket Man. So if you look at the, you know, people listening, if you just look at the lyrics to Rocket Man, imagine you are writing that, and that's all you're handing off to Elton.
Yes.
And then Elton sees the visual, he sees the drama, he sees the operatic quality, he sees the power ballad, because Rocket Man is one of the greatest. It's for me, it's one of the top five power ballads ever recorded.
Yes.
It just builds and builds and builds. And the fact that those words came first and that Elton set those words to music is, in and of itself, from an artistic standpoint, is, I was thunderstruck.
Yeah. But that's,
I always
work
knew
method.
That's how they were.
Yeah, that's huh? really remarkable. Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah. Especially and, Rocket Man, because they're spare, but they're complicated.
Yes.
And they're complicated, but they're not overly sophisticated. But they're not overly sophisticated to the point that you can't understand them. I mean, that's...
Well, you point out in the essay that he's talking about the mundane life of an astronaut. And when that record came out in 72, Americans were bored with moon landings. They didn't even get ratings. I think the last moon landing was in 72 or 71.
Yeah, this song had nothing to do with Bowie's space.
Right, of course, that we know. Yeah, which you pointed out.
Space Oddity, and it had nothing to do with Rocket Man by, what was the name of the group? I mentioned it in the book, but there's a group.
Yeah.
There's a group that had Rocket, the title
right.
Rocket Man. And they had heard none of those or didn't, neither one was an influence.
Right.
And then when I realized that, if you look at the date when it was written, it was right around the moon landing, when
yes.
everybody in this country was absolutely captivated by Walter Cronkite and the Eagle has landed and that. Gee,
right, but that was 69.
God, there's somebody on the moon.
Right. But by 72, we didn't really care about moon. I remember it didn't even get
that
much coverage on the
people
news.
People forget that there were 10 other moon landings, right?
Sure.
Where they took a car up there and drove around and they
golf
took samples.
Golf balls with Alan Shepard.
Yeah. Yeah, well, I mean, there's a lot of, you know, that one, that original moon landing was just one of them. But what all those other landings meant to Bernie as he was writing is that going to the moon became like garbage collection.
Yeah.
You know, it was like the shuttle. It was like not even the shuttle, but it was sort of like
routine.
You know, routine.
Yeah.
It was like taking out the trash. And that's the feeling he got in that song that. And that combined with the Ray Bradbury story, which is that being an astronaut isn't special anymore.
Right.
It's like driving a truck.
Incidentally, a quick Walter Cronkite point. I think it was about a week and a half ago, his townhouse on 84th Street just sold. And I was fascinated. It sold for about 8.4, which I thought was, you know, rather a low price for
the amazing thing is that the person who lives there is probably dishonest because they have that much money. I mean, it just seems in our culture today, the only way that you get that kind of money, unless you're an artist, unless you're talented, is through dishonesty, you know, like you took it from somebody else. So imagine that, you know, it's almost like this Twilight Zone episode where, you know, a very dishonest person is now living in a house of truth. Like that's where the most honest person in the news business lived. You know,
right,
it's almost
right.
like the ghosts of truth, the truth ghosts are going to haunt the dishonest person.
Don't get on the ship. It's a cookbook. I know.
Right. We're here. We're here to serve man.
This is flight number 914 from Earth to our planet. We will be taking off in 3 minutes.
Mr. Chambers. Mr. Chambers, don't get on that ship. The rest of the book, to serve man, it's a cookbook.
No!
That's it. So I want to give you the list of the 10 songs that were my favorites in the book. And let's pick another few to talk about if you have time. We'll obviously walk on by.
I think I brought my sleeping bag. I'm here. I think Good. You guys wanted me here until like next Thursday, right?
Yes, that's it's like fine. Jerry Lewis telephone.
That's fine. I'll get you some milk and cookies.
Yeah, that's right. We have to have somebody conduct the Count Basie band. Go ahead.
That's it. We've got Paranoid, Bang a Gong, which incidentally was the first million seller that my brother-in-law played on.
Wow.
Rocket Man.
Played on?
Yeah, he was Ian McDonald.
Oh,
who
no
just
kidding.
Passed away.
Wow.
Yeah. Smoke on the Water, Hello, It's Me, Love is the Drug.
Hello, It's Me.
Accidents Will Happen. And Take It Too Hard. Those were my like 10 favorites. So what do you want to talk about?
Well, I mean, tell me which one. I mean, what?
Most reluctant? You mentioned in the book that some artists tend to shy away from talking about their older material. Did you find that with any of these folks that you talked with?
No, because they talked to me about the past. I'm saying other artists that I tried to get tend to veer away from that because they don't want to talk about the past. Pete Townsend doesn't like to do that. Bono doesn't do that. Paul's talked out. There isn't anything. Yeah. I mean, Anthology basically did my job for me a long time.
Right.
There's nothing more to get out of him. Although I really did. The only song I wanted to interview him on was Maybe I'm Amazed for a variety of reasons, which isn't a Beatles song. It's a McCartney song prior to Wings, right? But Dylan said yes. Denny said no. Denny said yes. Denny said no. So that was an almost. And at the time, Bruce wasn't looking back either. So I did try to get everybody for this column. Did pretty well, all things considered. But those guys, I would say, were not really in the market to go back in time to revisit a... They were more interested in talking about the new album they had coming out, and they just felt it was a waste of time to be talking about something that dated.
We wanted to talk to Paul and not bring up the Beatles.
Well, we really enjoyed the Rick Rubin McCartney 3-2-1. I thought that was a new take on McCartney that no one had ever done before, where they just, it was just him and Rick Rubin in the studio. I thought that was pretty innovative anyway. But David, go ahead, pick out a song. Pick out one.
Let's see.
Press J7. It's like a jukebox.
That's it. Let's do Smoke on the Water. Everyone knows that. I'm thinking that should make a great klezmer tune.
Yeah, I mean, pick another one only because I it's a great story, but I think the basics, I mean, we'd need quite some time to sort of for me to get to the everybody kind of knows that the place caught fire and these guys watched the place, watched the Montreux concert hall burn and they were sitting in the bar and they wrote Smoke on the Water, but they couldn't get to record where they, so they couldn't record there. And then where they wanted to record next, they got thrown out of it, but they got the initial riff down. But there's a lot of great stuff in the book on it. It's just too many twists and turns there. I think
you're okie doke. How about either Bang a Gong or Love is the Drug? Pick which one you'd like to do.
Well, we can do. I mean, actually, you mentioned Burning Down the House, right?
Yes.
No.
Oh, no, we didn't. No, I'm sorry.
No.
Mm-mm. Let's do
You know what? Hello, It's Me, I think. Let's do Hello, It's Me. Because, Hello, It's Me it has such an interesting love story attached to it. The interesting thing, first of all, Todd is a great guy.
Yes. I mean, and he's been re-exploring his back catalog now. I think he's more comfortable with it than he used to be because now he's doing like Wizard True Star in its entirety and he's reaching back on the concert.
Yeah, I mean, back when I interviewed him, he wasn't.
Yeah, right.
But he was willing to.
Mm-hmm.
What's interesting about Todd is that he's so brilliant and eclectic. He's a producer. He's a songwriter. He's a musician. He has incredible vision. I mean, he's always a step ahead in terms of seeing what things should do. And he's, who else rivals Bowie for glam costume insanity? I mean, Todd is just way ahead of the curve in 71, 72. Yeah. Hello, It's Me comes out in 73, but... you see, I don't know whether you ever saw that movie short that he's in that I wrote about in the book. You can find that on YouTube.
Okay, I'll look it up.
Where they had glued they glued stuff to him and he couldn't get it off his skin and he's still scarred from it. That short is still on YouTube. And it's like 1971, I think.
Right.
And he's completely tricked out with glam. I mean, you know, he's really one of the fathers of glam. Todd in high school had long hair. And anybody who had long in high school, had long hair in high school, I did in the early 70s, knows that if you lived in New York City or Los Angeles or Chicago, you were fine for the most part. But if you didn't, if you lived in suburbia, you were harassed. And you were harassed endlessly and bullied for having long hair as a guy. Hair used to be a political statement. It's not anymore. Everybody has long hair. But back then, you got beat up for being a commie, a draft dodger, anti-American, queer. I mean, that all was grouped together and every athlete sort of took their turn picking on you and you kind of struggled to get home each day with either your lunch money, what was left of your lunch money, or your books, or your face. But Todd had long hair in high school, was dating a girl, and it was puppy love. They were very close, and he one day walked her home. Can't remember if he took the bus. They took the bus together, and he walked her from the bus stop. But he walked her home to her house, and coming up the driveway, her father, her crew-cut haired father, was watering the shrubs, the plants and things. It must have been June or September. And the father takes one look at Todd and turns the hose on him. And he goes, you know, he just turned the hose on him and chased Todd away and told his daughter, don't bring somebody like that home again, or else you're not going out ever again. And even though the daughter was upset about that, she told Todd, it's over. I can't, you know, I can't see you. He tried to come to see her. He brought her an outfit. I think it was a jumpsuit of some kind, if I recall. Again, it's in the book, Anatomy of 55 More Songs. And her sister was home. And he said, this is for, you know, this is for Linda, whatever her name was. And the sister took it. And when he left, he thought to himself, how embarrassing is this? I'm bringing outfits to my girlfriend's house and her sister's taking. I mean, he just realized the shame of it all and how he was groveling. And he wrote a song. And the song that he wrote, he decided, since he's in charge of writing the song, it could go any way he wants. So instead of writing about how he was dumped, you know, the three of us would have written something like, I walked you home, my heart was with you, but your dad was there and he soaked me with his hose. You know, we'd be writing stuff like that. But Todd, because he's an artist, a songwriting artist, he says, hey, I'm in control of the song. I'm breaking up with her. You know, she broke up with me, but it doesn't have to be that way. Let me write a song about how I would have broken up with her and maybe done things a little bit differently. You know, she called me and told me, I can't see you anymore. Goodbye. I'm going to break up with her, but I'm going to show her the right way to break up with somebody in this song. And hello, it's me were basically the first three imagined words that he would have said had he called her to break up with her. And that's first recorded for the first group he's in,
the Nas,
which is the Nas. And he doesn't sing it. I believe he's on keyboards on there, and I forgot who the lead singer is.
Stukey sang it.
Yeah, but it's almost funerary. And what I mean by that is, it's like a funeral dirge. It's very, very slow. Hello, it's me. I mean, it really drags. And nothing ever happened with the song. It didn't go anyplace. But years later, a bunch of years later, I think that was 1967. Yeah. It's around the time that Alice Cooper, the group, as a side note, decides to call themselves the Nas. They have to come up with a different name because their manager tells them that there is a group called the Nas already. That's this group that Todd's in. And so Alice Cooper comes up with Alice Cooper. But the Nas song, the Nas version doesn't go anywhere. And Todd has an album to put out, and while he's creating this, I think it's a double album.
Something Anything 72.
Yeah, it's a great album. If you don't own it, Go listen to it on Spotify. It's worth having the vinyl just to hear it in the original way it was.
There's a bad song on it.
It's true. It's like it rivals the Beatles' White Album, right? It's just loaded with great stuff. And Todd decides, you know, that he's going to do it for that album, and he's got people in the studio, and he, you know,
Sales Brothers on that track?
Tony were on it.
I believe so. But he creates these eighth notes, dun 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 dun, on the piano,
right?
That adds this, an urgency. I'm sorry.
Propulsion.
Yeah, propulsion, urgency. But it also has like this, this SOS, Morse Cody kind of sound to it, right? You know, it's kind of. You know, there's an urgency where you feel. So he's singing a ballad, really, a mid-tempo ballad, but it's pushing. It's pushing. You know, it's like the horse is pulling the. You know, it's pulling. It's not, horse isn't at ease. It's pulling faster than the person driving the cart wants to go, and, you know, it becomes a number five hit, and, you know, the thing about it is, that song is deeply influenced by Carole King's Tapestry, Todd told me. And that I don't think was known at the time.
Well, I know Laura Nero was a big influence on him.
Yeah, but it was specifically Tapestry. It's too late.
Meaning that version of it, because Tapestry came later.
Right, but I'm saying the version we know, we don't care about the Nas version. Right. You know, it's really, if you listen to it, it's like seeing a great car with the tires all flat, you know, it's just not, there's no mobility there. But for this, the hit song, the sound or the arrangement he wrote for the hit song, correct, Dave, to be more precise with my language, the arrangement that he came up with for Hello, It's Me, on the 1973 hit version, was deeply influenced by Tapestry, any of those songs. And I asked, is there anyone in particular? And he said, no. He said, it's just that it's the combination of melancholy and upbeat at the same time that I liked. I liked those two things that Carole King had going. And for this song, it's sort of like a shrug. You know, it's like, okay, you know, it's over, but onward, you know, on to the next.
Did he say the song, Maybe It's Too Late, Baby? Because now that I think about Tapestry and that, they're very similar.
It could be it's
same
too
tempo,
late.
Same piano type phrasing. Yep.
Yeah. You know, it's either one of those. It's funny. I just wrote a piece on Carly Simon's, as you know,
No Secrets.
And you know, The Right Thing to Do, which opens that album, ends exactly the same way as It's Too Late. If you listen to the two songs, if you listen to the two songs, they both have this major seventh, major ninth chord, bump, 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 bump. I mean, they end identically. And, you know, you sort of wonder whether Richard Perry wanted that to sort of be a salvo fired across Carole King's bow, meaning like, you know, hey, we're one upping you.
Yeah,
this is going to do better than your song. Watch. I don't believe, it didn't. You know, You're So Vain went to number one. I can't remember what The Right Thing to Do went to. It went to, into the top 10. Maybe
it was
the
top, but not a number one.
But at the same time, I've always found Carly Simon's to be better. I just like it better. It just feels sexier. I don't know how, you know, I'm just talking personally, how it just makes me, you know, it's like if your first girlfriend could sing, she'd sound like Carly Simon. You know what I'm saying? So it just has this, really interesting feel to it. Anyway, getting back to Hello, It's Me, those eighth notes, you know, as Dave reminded me, you know, it creates this sense of urgency. And, you know, if you listen to it on the album, you can see, or I think there's a version on YouTube, but I think it's the album version too. There's like a couple of false starts.
Yes, there is. Yes,
they
on
count
the album.
Off and it's not quite right. And then they do it again, 2, 3, 4.
No, bump, no, bump, no. Yeah, bump, right.
And it's not quite right again. And then the third time, And that all takes place within about 30 seconds, right?
Yes, yes.
But it's just this wonderful bit of raw fabric at the beginning. So you could almost hear...
it feels like you're in the studio with him.
Right. It's almost like, it to me, and I told Todd this and he laughed, it feels like you're looking at the engine of a great car, but you haven't seen the car yet. You know, like it's like a Ferrari or just this great MG or something, but the hood is up and you're just looking at the engine. And then suddenly somebody puts the hood down and you see the beauty of the car, the design, because you're hearing all the wiring on that introduction and you're hearing the false starts and you're hearing, you know, the carburetor. And then suddenly you hear the song come in and it's just this wave of beauty that washes over you.
Well, it's ironic that you point that out because there is another track on that record, and I might be even on the same side, where he goes through all the studio trickery.
It's the first song on the following side.
Right, where he says, okay, this is, you know, reverb, this is whatever, whatever. And of course, as kids, we didn't know. We didn't know what made records sound like they did.
It's just fun to hear. You know, it's this rawness where suddenly you're invited into the kitchen to sort of see how the spaghetti sauce is made or something.
Right.
That's cool, you know.
But what's interesting about that little tidbit is right after that, it gets you into almost a song that you could use in a commercial, that instrumental. It has very similarities to Pepperland, actually, from side two.
Yeah. I would love for there to be two pianos, and I would love Carole King and Todd Rundgren to be at each of those pianos, and I'd love for each of them to play the other song. In other words, have Carole King do Hello, It's Me, and Todd do It's Too Late.
Can't you get Wall Street Journal to pay for that?
But it'd be interesting, you know,
petition.
Yeah, get Rupert in on that. He'll do that.
I have to get Elon Musk or somebody at that level to hold a party where they're paying each of them $7 million to come and do that. That's the only time you'd get those people to do that.
No, they would do it. They would do it. Anyway.
Well, again, that album is worthy of if through the internet we could do all the songs on a record, that would be one to do.
Yeah, I mean, what your listeners should know is that, and this is kind of cool, I set it up this way for this purpose. If you go to my book site, markmyers.com, markmyers.com, I've put up there a Spotify playlist with all of the songs in my book in order. And if you keep pace with the reading, you know, if you can read each chapter in about 3.5 minutes, you will basically keep pace with the Spotify playlist. Obviously, you can stop the Spotify playlist. But it's kind of fun to listen to the duration of the song as you're reading the duration of the chapter. They're sort of like this virtual reality goggles quality to hearing the music while you're reading about the exact song.
Oh, that's what I love about that. Yeah,
because it's illustrated, you know, it's like you're reading something that's being illustrated by the real thing as you're reading about the song. Also, the other thing about the book is, it's a jukebox, meaning I didn't write this so people would start at chapter one and then only get like 30 pages
around,
in and put a dollar bill in and hope the next day they come back and read some more pages. You can go in at number 45,
go in at number
33, jump to 34, go all the way back to 15. You can go in anywhere and read as much as you want and then jump back, jump forward. You can go wherever your heart takes you.
There you go, David. Wherever your heart today takes you.
Okay. But me being the nerd that I am, I like listening to it chronologically.
And if you read it chronologically, if all you did was read the introductions to each of those chapters, you'd get the history of the music between 64 and 96.
Yeah.
Because that's how I set these songs up.
That, I think, is a very fascinating way to go as to – and just the change in sonics – as each song goes, I think.
Did you like the introduction sort of set it up and, you know, not only set up how the song did, but also puts the song. I wanted to put the song in the time frame.
Yeah, that's so very important.
Because it then makes the song itself more relevant and more meaningful to the reader rather than just, you know, here's the guitar so-and-so used, and here's the studio they recorded at, by putting it in its context and telling you what was going on and why glam was emerging when it was emerging and why Bang a Gong, you know, it makes sense and it's so special.
You've done that in all your books and all your writing. You always put things into it. It's
there's
so
a
very
documentary
important.
Here.
Thank
there's
you.
There really is.
A rockumentary, yeah. No.
I would never think that as a 12-year-old buying Love It to Death and something, anything, that I would be talking about it 50 years later and it would be documented in such a way. It's inconceivable back
You're
then.
Just old.
Yeah. I am. Yes, I am. Yeah. Anyway, so. All right, Marc, thanks for being a guest.
Hey, Tom, Dave, you know, the only sad part about this is I'm actually going to have to write another book to see you guys again.
No, you won't. We'll figure something out. Are you working on it? Can you give us a hint of anything else?
You know, there's a couple of things cooking, but there's nothing set yet, so I don't want to let that cat out of the bag.
All right.
So.
Well, thanks for being our guest. And David, the highlight of the interview, of course, was Mark's Keith Richards imitation. I think that was priceless.
This is true. This is true. We will play this. Actually, Keith doesn't live that far from me.
Yes, David. Go.
Gives it a little flavor there, right?
There you go. Rock and roll.
It's funny. When I interviewed him the second time, he knew what it was for. And he calls up and he says, I answer, you know, pick up the phone, Marc Myers. He says, "Hello, Marc, it's Keith. It's Keith." I said, "Keith, how you doing, man?" He goes, "It's time for the anatomy. Get out the scalpel. Get out the scalpel. It's time for the anatomy." Yeah. So he was sort of having flashbacks to the last time we spoke when I took him by the ankles and held him over the windowsill and shook all his change out of his pockets. So he was prepared to be turned upside down again and have every detail shaken out about Take It So Hard.
You know,
which is a great song and proof positive of where the real genius of the Rolling Stones was.
Yeah.
And that's my personal perspective.
That would have made a classic Rolling Stones
and
record.
That was so sad. That was so touching. It was so sad when he was saying that to me. I don't want to spoil it for the reader, but the ending was so it was so blue, you know. There was so much regret and such a feeling of sadness, and also knowing where the line was, you know, for Keith, that it was never going to be done by the Stones, and that the two were, you know, they're over here and I was over there, and that you don't mix those.
And again, going back to historical, I remember as a fan buying that record in 87, we didn't think the Rolling Stones were going to get back together. That was it. We thought they were done. And this is what we had. We had Keith.
That's the beauty of the Stones for me.
Yeah.
You know, having interviewed, I interviewed Bill Wyman, not for the book, but I interviewed Mick as well for my last book. And what's interesting about these guys is when the Peacock show is over, you know, when you get beyond the showmanship and the cool cigarette smoking headbands, strutting on stage with the cape on stuff, when you get past that, and you're just talking to someone, you know, talking to Mick or Keith on the phone, and you're talking about art, there's a blueness, there's a blue coloration that you reach with these guys, and you realize what makes them special. And it's this sense of grittiness, this earthiness, this tremendous sense of sadness. And that they work, that they've given up, sacrificed so much for what they do, meaning family time, downtime, you know, enjoying life time. They're touring and constantly working on new music. And, you know, they missed out on a lot, but they did that all so that people like us would have music to listen to.
Right.
Forget that about artists, how hard they work and what they have to go through physically and emotionally to bring us the stuff that we love. I mean, after music, you know, what's after music that unites everybody? Probably spaghetti, and then that's it, right?
Probably. What did you think of Bill Wyman's books? What do you think of his historical?
You know, I think they're vital, but they lack a certain. You know, they're not narrative driven.
Right. Right.
You know, you're not. I think people only make time for books today where there's a story being told on some level. Yeah. But I think as a person who acquires and annotates and details It's great that a band like the Rolling Stones had somebody like Bill to gather the information and document it the way he did, because ultimately, as the years go by, all of these memoirs are colored. There's a coloration that they, you know, who knows if Keith got that right, or he, you know, can they really check? Can the fact checkers really find out whether it was this particular concert work that Keith was talking about? So there's a lot of gray area and a lot of loose parts in a memoir. But with Bill Wyman's books, they're so screwed down tight in terms of dates, what happened, where they happened, you know, what was going on, who had the fight on which night, what was the reason. I mean, it's almost like Jack Nicholson's, you know, Jack, what's the film where he's the crazed
Shining.
Axe?
Oh, yes.
Yeah, it's almost like The Shining, right? It's like The Shining level of passion on Bill's part to document everything. But like I said, when you talk to Mick for a period of time, or Keith, you realize that there is this blue streak that that you rarely get to experience unless you're getting serious about what they do, rather than just a fan or just somebody writing a quick and dirty for some music magazine. They have to get all this flavor about how stoned they were or something.
Yeah, you know? Sure. Unfortunately. Yeah. Okay.
Clickbait.
And speaking lastly of 1972, there is a book now out called on the Stone 72 tour.
Yep.
Which was, we talked about in your previous book, you put the modern rock concert at 75, but I thought it was going to be 72, but it's pretty much the same.
I can't remember when I put I can't remember which.
I thought it was the 72 tour, maybe.
I think it was, because the modern rock concert is an indoor event, you know, for the most part. You know, it's a lot of small psychedelic dungeons, as Steve Miller called them, up until 72. And then 72, you start to get, you know, I mean, Led Zeppelin, I think, is in Madison Square Garden in 69, but it's not, it doesn't become like the Stones tour yet.
Wasn't 72 the first time they got corporate endorsement with Jovan, I believe. So that's really.
Yeah. And also they by then they had their branding. I mean,
The t-shirt came out, the tongue, right?
I mean, if you, I don't count the Beatles T in the Ringo's drum kit, although the logo, you know, although it is a logo.
Afterwards,
and the Who had
a
logo prior, but it's not until the Stones tongue and lips that you know, you don't need words to.
Right.
That was a great story in rock concert, wasn't it? Marshall Chess's description of how he landed on the fact that the Stones needed a wordless brand, because he was driving in Europe and was going to Shell stations that didn't say Shell, but he knew it was Shell.
Right.
Yeah.
And they decided, you know, they needed something that was instantly identifiable, but there weren't words.
Right. Exactly. You know,
it was just an image of some sort.
And that's when rock becomes an acceptable part of the entertainment business.
It starts to become that's when the ship leaves the pier, setting sail for the multi-billion dollar industry.
Right, right. You have folks like Alice Cooper on Hollywood Squares and things.
Well, I think too, if you really give it some thought, it wasn't so much. Well, the date is the business, which was nascent. Up to that point, they were still working out all the details. That's when they knew they could really put the screws to everyone.
Yeah, well.
Yeah, except, you know, Woodstock and Altamont does rock a very big favor. Woodstock, because the fear of what could have happened had things gone wrong, terrified every community in the country, and they started to pass new laws prohibiting that size. Unless you had X number of portisans and X amounts of gallons of water, and
police.
They really put their foot down. They wouldn't grant a license unless those conditions were met. And then Altamont sends the rock concert into new sports arenas because what sports arenas do for the rock business is you don't have to worry about the weather. You don't have to worry about the temperature. You don't have to worry about health stuff. You don't have to worry about
bathrooms. It's a controlled environment. Yeah.
Controlled environment. And the only thing that they had to figure out was how are we going to maximize seating? And for a long time, they couldn't maximize seating behind the artist in these arenas. And it's not until the wireless mic and the wireless guitar that they're able to do a 360 degree.
Right, exactly. Yeah, technology.
Well, think about the early Beatle concerts.
And actually, it's the flying junkyard that changes everything, where instead of mounting speaker systems like the Dead on stage, so that the reason the people in the back, you couldn't sell the seats, is you couldn't see anything.
Right.
And a lot of the people in the audience couldn't see because speakers were in the way. It's not until they figure out that the Disney on Parade crews that come in to these arenas, because they're the only ones capable of staging things in arenas, ice-capades, things like that.
They
say, why do you have these speakers on stage? You know, let's get them up in the air. And they take all these speaker systems and they call them the flying junkyard, because the speaker systems look like junk. I mean, they were all different shapes and sizes, and they hoist them up with chains and they bring them all the way up to the ceiling. And now you've got a 365 degree view.
Right.
And then you start to see ticket prices go up as well.
Yeah. Right. Box office. Mm-hmm. Yeah. All right, sir. All right, Mark.
You're throwing me out, right?
We're throwing you.
Yeah.
we'll have him back. We'll read the seven secrets, David, and then we'll talk about that.
Yeah, you need to tell me, where are you going from here?
Where are you going from here, Mark?
Oh, yeah, okay, that's enough. I get it.
That's what my wife's grandmother used to say. You're not going to let the cat out of the bag.
Right, my wife's grandmother used to say, like, when she had enough family.
Elise is a writer, right?
Yeah.
Your wife? Yeah, okay.
Well, her grandmother would say to the family, where are you going from here? Which would basically be shorthand for, it's time to go.
Yeah.
All right. Okay.
All right, guys. So you can use that for your next guest. You can use that. Where are you going from? What do you got? What are you doing? What are you doing later this afternoon?
Right.
What else have you got to do today?
What are you doing in 5 minutes?
Your problem is it's a pre-holiday week, so I have nothing going on except writing this afternoon.
All right, there you go.
All right, guys.
Great. Happy holidays, of course.
I'll write as fast as I can to get my next book done so I can see you again. But for the time being, I'll see you on Facebook. Great job, guys, as always.
All right.
Yeah. Really great to see you, too.
Okay, Dave. Take care, man. See
you. Pressed out. Bye-bye.